you got here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and a ho, 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 Merry Christmas to all of you.
I am producer Dave. Yes, Merry Christmas. Crimbo is upon us yet again, and we have some festive treats as per usual.
And I don't want to say it's like the year. And this is the thing. Everyone keeps on telling me, it's like, oh, wow, it's December 2023 already. It's flown by. It didn't fly by for me at all. Did you feel the same way, producer Dave? Did 2023 fly by for you?
There were months where I can't remember, but it kind of dragged, especially during the summer, where where I was hoping for some nice weather and all we got was rain.
Yeah, I mean, for me, loads of spots really dragged. So I remember the first. The beginning of spring, and it was drag may not necessarily be a bad thing, because some of the things, so I did enjoy 2023, but it has been a long year for me, not just for me personally, but I feel it. But I guess the older I get, the more I feel time drag. So it's like whenever somebody says, oh, it's like, oh, the year's just flown by, my response is always, no, it hasn't. It went at its normal pace. If anything, it felt longer. So I feel that's what the case is. I feel the year has dragged its feet for us to get to Christmas. And this December for me has been the longest, because it's like we're recording this, we're almost at Christmas, but it still feels miles away. I don't know. But anyway, enough about my rabbiting on. About stuff. Producer Dave, I always like to ask you what you've been watching recently, and what TV shows or movies you've been watching recently. Let's talk about that before we jump into our film and TV news segment. So what have you been watching recently?
Not much new. I mean, if you remember listening to us last time, I was rabbiting on about Unprisoned.
Yes. Which is on Disney Plus. Yes.
Yes, that's right. And I just finally finished watching it and restarted it and watched it all again. There were some episodes in there. There was one that made me laugh myself silly. And also, one of the things I forgot to tell you was that the other thing that I really liked about the series was the music that they chose to go accompany it with. Have you heard, or do you remember, Terry Lewis and Jimmy Jam?
I remember Jimmy Jam. Terry Lewis obviously sounds familiar. Give me a song that they've done.
Well, think of the Janet Jackson tunes, and yes, they were the producers behind most of her albums.
Sure. So things like What Have You Done For Me Lately? Dun, 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 yeah. Dun. Ooh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay. So they chose quite a lot of the tunes that were in there. And one of the episodes, they chose it went really well with the episode, because the episode was called Have You Got a Mother Wound? And, and I won't tell you what happened in there. It will give too much away. But one of the songs they chose to accompany that was an old song called She's a Bad Mamma Jamma, which
had
me in stitches, because, well, the scene that it comes up on is just really funny. But when I went on to online, I noticed that there was a lot of people who were using that tune to do a dance routine. And you saw elements of that in that episode as well. And I didn't realize that they'd been using it. So I thought, ah, I see where that had come from, if you see what I'm saying.
Okay,
Yeah,
all
so
right.
yeah. So
Because
yeah.
you, I know, I remember when you mentioned it last week. You were talking about it, and obviously, it has Delroy Lindo and Kerry Washington in it.
That's
And I
right.
really like both of them. Seen them in different things. Obviously, Scandal for Kerry Washington, Delroy Lindo in numerous films, going across the decades, and most recently on TV in The Good. Was he in? He was in The Good Fight, not in The Good Wife. He was in The Good Fight. And he was great in that. If you don't know who I'm talking about and you don't want to watch the movies, there's a clip that's been going viral from The Good Fight, which a lot of people actually mistake for being something that happened on TV, where he, because in The Good Fight he's a lawyer and he's brought on to this news discussion panel, and they want, kind of like, like Breakfast or Good Morning or the one that the ladies have, and it's a Whoopi Goldberg and all those people, they're
Oh,
on there.
yeah.
And he's been brought on as a guest panelist at one point. And he's so, because of the kind of the passion that he delivers, and he's so charismatic, they love him in the show. So they love him as the guest. And what they do is the network actually, they ask him to come back on as more of a permanent guest. So he is, like a permanent member
Analyst.
of a panelist. Thank you, a more permanent panelist. And he's like, yeah, sure, it's a great idea. So he shows up and he's expecting to see the other black panelist that was there, so they can chat and whatnot in the makeup chair. And he's there, and he asked the makeup lady, he's like, "Where's the other guy?" I was like, "You didn't hear?" He's like, "No." It's like, "They fired him." It's like, "Why did they fire him?" He's like, "Why do you think?" So it's kind of like, oh, so they had to they hired him to replace the other black panelist. Rather just get him on there and keep another black, just have two black panelists, right? And so that's the setup for the viral clip. The clip that goes viral is him sitting there while they're going live, they're talking, and he's there, and somebody asks him a question. You just see, so he sort of wakes up, and the question they're discussing is kind of about using the N-word in rap lyrics and stuff. And he flips and goes into the bit where he's like, "Go on, I want to hear you say it." He's talking to the other white panelists. He's like, "I want you like the song, right? I want to hear you say it." And you can see him like mortified. It's a great clip. That is Delroy Lindo. I'm gonna go watch. It's Unprisoned, you said, right? Unprisoned
Unprisoned, yeah. Don't
on
forget the
Disney
Five
Plus.
Bloods as well, because he's in that.
Yes, he's in the Five Bloods. Yes, he's the I'm not gonna say I'm not gonna say what character he plays, but yes, he's in the Five Bloods most recently. So that's great guy, actor. And Kerry Washington, love Kerry Washington, she's fantastic. For me, I'm still catching up on the stuff that I've mentioned last week. The Americans, which is on Disney Plus, I'm on the third season of The Morning Show, which is on Apple TV. And Mini Marcus, I've gotten him. I don't know if I mentioned this last week, but he saw a clip of The Punisher and something, and he really, really liked The Punisher. And so, because Punisher is my favorite comic book character of all time. I mean, you say him, maybe Marv from Sin City, but definitely Punisher. And so he wanted to watch the new TV series for Punisher. So I said, "Look, don't go and start with the series. Let's get you with the introduction from Daredevil season two." So we watched Daredevil season two, we finished Daredevil season two, we're now into Punisher season one. We're like four episodes in. So that's another one that I'm enjoying binge watching. It's such a great show, and I'm so happy to hear there's news that he's coming back. They're most likely going to do a new Punisher series, and it's like fantastic. They bring back the good people from the Netflix shows, and reboot their TV series. Obviously, keeping the main characters, because the actors will play the main characters, because they're all fantastic. You're listening to Shooting the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm producer Dave.
And I must obviously be on the Christmas eggnog because I'm starting to slur my speech. I'm like, yeah, let's get ourselves to Christmas where we can enjoy some good Christmas movies and TV shows, which is what we're going to be talking about in the spotlight. We're going to jump in and talk about our top five Christmas movies. I'll bring my top five, producer Dave. You bring your top five. We used to do top fives for different categories ages ago. We haven't done it in a while. Let's bring it back for Christmas, shall we? Let's get all nostalgic. But before we do that, let's jump into film and TV news. Now, at the top of our film and TV news segment, before we jump back into some of the merriment, we want to celebrate an actor who has been he's been in some of the best roles I've seen. He's played some of the best roles as he just stop rambling because the guy he passed away recently. Andre Brower. Those of you who may recognize the name, some of you may know who I'm talking about. Some of you who don't know who I'm talking about. Most recently, he played Captain Holt on Brooklyn Nine-Nine. He was fantastic on that show. In the past, other people might recognize him. The first time I ever saw him was in Homicide: Life on the Street. That's the one where he got a number of Emmys because that show, that was he was he just his he was so good. If you were to ask me, which actors bring gravitas to any role that they play? That is, he would be the first person that would just pop into my head. Obviously, you think people like James Earl Jones, you think about Morgan Freeman, you think about Denzel Washington, you think about, Anthony Hopkins, you think about all those kind of people. Sure, they, when you mention them, Bryan Cranston, right? Those are people that that they'll bring a sense of gravitas to and I'm talking male actors. Obviously, we can go to female actors, talk about Viola Davis, Meryl Streep, and so on and so forth. Yes, we can rattle through those lists. But for me personally, when you say the word gravitas, the first person that pops in my head is Andre Brower. That's the first person who always popped in my head. Fantastic, fantastic actor. Obviously, a lot of his stuff, he's known for drama. I remember he did a TV show. Which was it only ran for one season, and I don't know why it got cancelled because it's just ridiculous. And I'm just double checking to make sure. Well, I guess they did as a mini series is Thief. It's based on a 70s movie with James Caan, and it's called Thief. I remember seeing that. It came out in 2006. Loved that show. Just kept wanting it to come back. He's basically the head of this this crime. This he has a team of criminals, but he's also got a family man as well, and he has to try to keep the life balance and organize his crimes. Kind of like imagine Heat, the TV series. That's what Thief was. Brilliant show. But everyone else knows him from Homicide: Life on the Street. He popped up in different other films as he went along. He was in Rise of the sorry, Fantastic Four, Rise of the Silver Surfer. Played a bit role in that. He was in House. There was a he played a psych was a psychiatrist in the later seasons of I think the second to last season of House. He popped up in there and he went toe to toe with Hugh Laurie. Great actor, but then obviously last couple of shows that he's been on, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and I believe he's on the last season of The Good Fight. I haven't caught that season yet, but he's on there. I've seen clips of it, and I want to watch it. But he passed away this week. They haven't really put out, at the time of this recording, they haven't put out what was the cause of death, but he died at the on the 11th of December. And he died at the age of 61. I don't know, producer Dave. When I say Andre Brower, does he resonate with you? Is this someone that you've seen in films and TV shows that you recognize?
The main TV show that I recognize him from is Brooklyn Nine-Nine. And I'm not really a fan of Brooklyn Nine-Nine, but he always stood out in Brooklyn Nine-Nine. That straight-laced face, he just came across really well.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I'm a huge fan of Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I've seen the show multiple times. One of my favorite episodes of the entire what it has like seven season run. There's one if you were to tell me get rid of every other episode and keep that one, that is my number one favorite episode of the entire show is The Box, and it's him, it's Adam Sandberg, Sterling K. Brown is obviously again. talk about gravitas, talk about actors with gravitas. You've got these two actors that you throw them into any dramatic role and they are fantastic. But this Brooklyn Nine-Nine is silly comedy, and the two of them just play it off so brilliantly. It's Andre Brower brought he just as you described, he's like that stoic figure, right? He's a stern face, and that's what his character is. If you don't know Brooklyn Nine-Nine, it's focusing on the precinct, the 99 precinct in Brooklyn, obviously police, and the police officers that are there, the detectives that are there are wacky and crazy, and they like to have fun. Adam Sandberg is leading them. They always play games, and they're good at their job. Three of them, four of them, five of them. Yeah, most of them are good at their job. There are two in particular that are terrible. There are two in particular that are terrible. So I was going through it. I was like, no, but
Always
he's
going to
good.
the
No,
deli.
she's good. She's great. And then it was like, no, it's the other two that are just terrible. But they're part of the team. And so they muck around quite a lot. And so they, and the very first episode, they bring in Captain Holt, who's there, who's a straight-laced, by-the-books guy who wants, he's supposed to shape up the group. And that dynamic, he comes in and he's brilliant. And he's there throughout the entire show. And you see the character arc with him as Captain Holt is just, a lot of people may not know his work, but it's just Andre Brower, fantastic actor. Rest in peace. I'm gonna go and find Thief and rewatch that show because I remember watching it. It had such an impact on me, even though it was back in 2006. Wasn't refocused much on that stuff, even though I was watching a lot of TV shows. I saw him pop up. Hadn't seen him before. I'd seen him in Homicide: Life in the Street. Loved that. That was back in the 90s. Then he popped up, and I was like, absolutely great. I want to watch that show. I watched it. Loved it. Hoped there would be another season. There wasn't another season. And then seeing him popping up in different films, that was great. And then coming to Brooklyn Nine-Nine and just killing it. Absolutely killing it.
There was one
So,
more thing about Brooklyn Nine-Nine. His character
yes.
was gay, and he played it. He was not the typical gay man that you saw in TV shows or what have you. He played it completely straight, but he was there with his husband, talking about his stuff, and people just didn't know where to put their face when they first heard about it. You could see the shock on their face when they first found out he was gay, but he was just like himself all the way through. So yeah, that was the other reason for me sort of like staying tuned when I saw the first few episodes that I did see. Like I said, wasn't really a fan of the show, but kind of was drawn to his character because he did play it so well.
Honestly, we could dedicate this entire episode just to talking about him and talking about Brooklyn Nine-Nine, but we've got it's a Christmas episode, so let's move on to other things. We just want to say Merry Christmas and rest in peace, Andre Brower. And yeah, your memory will live on to us Brooklyn Nine-Nine fans, even though producer Dave thinks that the show was terrible. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm producer Dave.
And I jumped on IMDb this morning trying to look for ideas for TV shows or Christmas, yeah, for Christmas TV shows. But then I saw a list that popped up and I was like, well, that's true. This is the end of the year. This is going to be the last episode we're going to do for 2023. And so let's do some recapping of some of the things that had graced our television channels and our TV screens from 2023. I figured we're going to look at the top TV series of 2023. So what we'll do is we'll go from 10 to 1. And producer Dave, I'd like to find out if you, being a resident of the United Kingdom, watched any of these TV series. And if you did, what did you think about them? So let's start with number 10, which is Star Trek Picard. Did you watch Star Trek Picard?
No, I haven't even seen the first one episode. I just wasn't, it didn't drag me to it. If it didn't, even though the Borg, oh gosh, the Borg convert was due back in there,
Yes.
and some of the other ones, I just didn't, it just didn't appeal to me.
That's 7 of 9, you mean?
Yes, seven of nine,
Yes.
seven. Yeah, she,
Yes.
even though she was in it as well.
A whole bunch of people from the original show pop back in. Data pops back in at one point. Jonathan Frakes, he pops back in. I saw the first half of the first season. Didn't carry on from there. But I've heard a lot of people slam it. But again, the people I've heard slam it are the ones who were delighted that She-Hulk was a trash. I'll put it that way. So I'm not really taking their word for it because I haven't seen a lot of fans of the show raving about it to counteract what the others are saying. But for me, while I wouldn't call myself a Trekkie, I do watch whenever they have their stuff. And so I started watching some of the episodes. I haven't gone back into it, so it didn't really hold me, but I did see it and I thought it was all right. Let's move on to number nine. Hoska. This is again a Star Wars story, Hoska, which is following, if I'm pronouncing her name correctly, Hoska Kattan. Did you see this, Priest Dave?
I didn't even know
Oh,
it
you see, it's on Disney Plus, so it's obviously part of the Disney, the world of Star Wars. So it's one of the characters from Star Wars, the Star Wars myth. You saw Mandalorian.
Oh, you're talking about the woman with
Yes.
the thingies. Oh, I've been meaning. Sorry, it's the way you said it. It's
Oh, Ahsoka. Sorry, I said Ahsoka. I apologize. There are tons of Star Trek, Star Wars Star. I said Star Trek. They're gonna kill me. They're gonna kill me. A ton of Star Wars fans are about to jump through their headphones and stab me in the throat, and I deserve it. It's Ahsoka Kattan, not Ahsoka. Ugh! I told you, I'm on the eggnog.
Yeah, it's one of those series that I've been meaning to watch. I just haven't had the bandwidth to sit down and sit there and watch it all the way through. So, but I will be watching it. She popped up in The Mandalorian and The Mandalorian Part Two, which was on in the Boba Fett series. But yeah, she played an important part in that. And yes, there was some talk about her and Luke possibly getting together that I saw online somewhere, but I haven't watched it yet, so.
Fair enough. That's played by Rosario Dawson. I've seen two, no, three episodes of it. I did want to go back in. I didn't get the chance to go back in because, again, tons of stuff I want to watch. But yeah, so that's that. It's Ahsoka, which is on Disney Plus. Do not kill me, Star Wars fans. Number eight, The Witcher. I believe season three of The Witcher came out. Did you see The Witcher?
No, I didn't. I started to watch it and then I lost Netflix. So I haven't seen any of that. I believe what's his name left the main guy left what's his name again? He went
Henry
back.
Cavill.
Yeah, Henry Cavill. He left to see if he could pick up his Superman role again, but that
Yeah,
fell through.
I haven't. If I have, no, I haven't. I haven't watched the third season of The Witcher, which is weird because I loved the first season. I really, really loved the first season. I thought it was great. Then I read the book. And a lot of people were saying how the first season isn't as good as the book. I read the book. I was like, nah, man, I prefer the TV show to the book. And there's one story in particular that was done in the TV show that is much better, in my opinion, than the book. And then we moved on to season two, and I watched season two, and I was like, it is all right. It's good. It's good. I mean, not so bad. It was all right. Good. Not as memorable as the first one. And then I think they did a prequel season, and then season three, and I just didn't watch season three. So I'll go and check when I get the chance. I will watch it just so that I can be a completist and see what it's like. But yeah, I haven't seen the third season. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And we are counting down IMDb's Best of 2023 TV series in the UK. And number seven is Sex Education. Producer Dave, have you seen any episodes of Sex Education?
One or two, but I didn't watch. I wasn't watching
You
it.
were okay, fair enough. Well, I'm a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of Sex Education. I love the first season. Second season, I really, really liked it. Third season, I thought was very good. It's like going down. The fourth season is, I don't want to call it a mess. I will say it was rushed. It feels, to me, it feels rushed and incomplete because they completely changed the setting. They obviously moved from one school to another school, introduced a whole bunch of new characters, spent way too much time on some characters and not enough time on other characters. And I watched this interview thing where one of the main writers of this the last season talked about how she'd written a lot about a particular character and they had edited it out completely. So there are a lot of decisions made by that particular character. I'm not going to say which character it is because I want people to go and watch the show. There are certain decisions made by or the direction of a particular character that you're thinking, what are you doing? That just doesn't make any sense, and so on. So and there was the result of that, I guess, was or the cause of that apparently was the fact that a lot of it was edited out. But hey, who knows? Either way, as top 10 seasons or series of 2023, I'm okay with this being on the list. A lot of the actors from this show are blowing up now in different places. Nkuti Gatwa is now the new doctor, which is great. Emma Mackey, she's fantastic. Asa Butterfield, always, he's very, very good. He's popped up on a Uber advert recently with Robert De Niro. And I saw a pop up the other day. I was like, "Hey, how you doing? Good." Anyway, that's Sex Education. It's on Netflix. You can go check it out. Number six is Unforgotten. This is a cold case crime drama that I believe aired on ITV. Producer Dave, have you seen this show?
Nope, didn't see this one either.
I've seen this, but it's got five seasons, right? And I've seen it being advertised. It's got Sanjeev Bhaskar, it's got Sinead Keenan in it, great actors. And every time I see it being advertised, it always seems like it's a great show. And in fact, it says, although IMDb fans gave the season its lowest ratings to date, the season premiere pulled in 8.4 million viewers, and that's to ITV. So, it must be a great show. I'll give it a chance. I'll give it a chance. I'll go check it out and see what it's like. But moving on from that one is number five, You, which is on Netflix. Producer Dave, have you seen You?
If it's on Netflix, the answer's going to be no.
Okay, so You is the one, is the stalker drama, stalker thing where the main character, I can't remember his name, but he's a stalker essentially, and he's a serial killer and whatnot. That's not a spoiler. That's pretty much from that's the whole sales point of the show. You're following the bad guy essentially. And yeah, the season dropped. I think it's the second to the last season, or they did a half season or whatever, dropped, and a lot of people like it. I haven't seen a single episode of it, and I don't think I'm gonna see it. So let's move on to number four, which is Happy Valley, another ITV featured TV show. Producer Dave, have you seen Happy Valley?
I've seen it advertised and I think I've just been missing it. So no, I haven't seen it. It's one of those that I think I might tune into, but I keep missing when it's on.
Yeah, I've never seen an episode of it, but I've heard good things. It had a it had a 7 year break, and then they did it the final season. So it's three seasons, right? So it's it, they did two seasons and then stopped for 7 years, and then came back this year and did the final season. So they did a time jump, and it's apparently been it was massive, fantastic TV show. All right, number three, we'll do a quick run through of number three, two, one, then we'll jump into Spotlight. And number three was The Mandalorian. I think we've raved massively about The Mandalorian for quite
Yeah,
a minute.
definitely did.
What did you think about the third season?
I have to say that towards the end of the third season, I started to get a little bit disappointed.
A lot of people said the same thing, yeah.
Yeah, but I think from what I've been hearing that there is a fourth season there, but one of the news reports is that what they might do is compress the fourth season and make it a film.
Yeah.
So it may turn out to be that there's no fourth season, but there is a film, or you may get the fourth season. I don't know. I'd much rather the fourth season, to be quite honest, than the film.
Yeah, I guess. So they can spread it out. Number two is The Last of Us. What did you think? That's the adaptation of the video game with Pedro Pascal. and Bella Ramsey. Did you see the show?
No, I didn't see the show. No, it's
Oh,
one of, it's on my list.
it's great. It was on Sky. It is fantastic. It's also on HBO Max. I am 100% behind the show. I would happily go back and watch it again. Loads, and I never played the game. A lot of people were saying, "Oh, you play the game and it's different." I haven't heard anybody say bad things about the show. Everyone has always said that, especially in, well, actually, no, I'll rephrase. There's one episode in particular that a lot of people said bad things about it. However, those people that said bad things about it are again kind of that group I was mentioning about that mocked the, the what you call it, either way, idiot people didn't like the show. That's how that's my hot take. Idiot people didn't like The Last of Us. And number one of the year was Black Mirror. So Black Mirror came back after a 4-year hiatus on Netflix. Producer Dave, you said you haven't seen it, but I like Black Mirror. They had a couple of good episodes in there. It wasn't as great as its previous seasons, but yeah. So that's the wrap up of the top series of 2023. Producer Dave, you have a piece of news before we jump into Spotlight?
Yeah, just before we jump into film and not film and TV news, we've already done that. No, just before we jump into Spotlight, there's something that's going to be going on with TVs, and I'm talking about the actual TV itself, the thing that you watch things on. Currently, most everyone's got a TV that can accept a Freeview signal. But from next year, what you're going to start finding in the shops is TVs that accept a freely, well, come with freely. Freely is going to eventually replace Freeview. At the moment, Freeview gets the signal from an aerial. Freely will not do that. It will get things, you'll be able to watch programs over the internet. So it will be internet-based TV. You won't need an aerial, you won't need a satellite. And starting from next year, you're going to find more and more of those types of TV on sale. What does this mean for people? Well, in the next 10, 5 years, 10 years, basically, you will need to have broadband to be able to watch TV. That is essentially it. You're going to have broadband. You won't be able to get it through the dish or aerial any longer. It means that your TV will become smarter in some respects because they will all come with the catch-up TV channels, the ITVX, the BBC iPlayer, etc., etc. But what you get will be essentially the same as what you've got on Freeview. Now, for some people, that's going to be great because it means that no more atmospheric conditions which disrupt the TV signal and what have you. However, if you haven't got a broadband or you haven't got a stable broadband that gives you a fast enough service, that is going to put pressure on you as well. But we're talking about the time frame is sort of like from 2024 onwards. So it's probably going to take 5, 6 to 10 years before Freeview is all shut down and it's all on broadband. But I just thought that's a bit of TV news that is relevant for a lot of people who are going to be watching TV. And if you've got a good broadband signal and you're going to change your TV very shortly anyway, you may as well hold off and get one which is freely enabled. The first manufacturer that's going to bring one of those is Hisense, but they will all be signing up very shortly anyway because they intend to get rid of the aerial signal at some point in the future. So, yeah.
Oh, I did not know that. Thank you very much, Producer Dave, for letting us know. If when in the new year, when I'm looking to get a new TV, that is what I will be looking forward to as well. And just before we jump into our film and TV news segment, I just caught on the news. I don't know, Producer Dave, if you've heard this, but what we had this conversation a couple of weeks ago where we talked about how streaming services like Netflix withhold their viewing figures for certain programs, and it's been announced. Netflix has kind of announced recently that they are going to start rolling out twice a year viewing figures for their shows. The only caveat is each show to qualify for what they'll put on there. Your show or movie, and this is whether it's legacy movies, whether it's something they've purchased or their own original creations. As long as you have 50,000 hours viewing. So as long as it, so you have to hit that threshold. So the project has to hit that threshold, 50,000 hours viewing. That's when it'll then go on to the release of what they'll show. So it kind of answers that question, because one of the things I was talking about is how you can never really find out how much how many views you have for your film if you sell it to Netflix. This way, they're now it answers that question. They will be doing that, which is great. It's great, because at the end of the day, if you're not having up to 50,000 hours viewing, I mean that amount could be a little lower for independent filmmakers and for those people who are not as famous as the Scorsese's and other huge celebrities that are getting some Netflix time. But it's still a start, right? It's a start. You get your you twice a year they'll release the stats. You get to see what the viewing figures are for different shows. And while that is a great thing, it's not an altruistic action on Netflix's part, I guess, if you were to really consider, the timing of them having done that. Obviously, backlash from them not having done it might have reached a groundswell, especially with the SAG-AFTRA strikes. Talked about how Orange is the New Black. We never really got to see royalties. The actors never got to see huge dividends on the royalties that were paid out, even though we know how many. We don't know how many viewers have watched it, but it was a Netflix original and it's been on for years. It pretty much brought loads of people to the site, and as such, either way, it Netflix and have now rolled out a subscription tier which is free but with ads, right? So Netflix have
It's
a
not
subscription tier,
free. It's
but
not free.
it's not free. How much is
No,
it?
good gosh, no. It's not free. You pay, I think it's a fiver,
You pay a
4.99.
fiver, but you still have ads,
Do you
right?
have ads? Yeah. But also,
They
you don't, you, there's a lot of other restrictions as well. You don't get the high definition, and you can only, I think, screen it on one device.
Okay, so that's even worse. It brings it down. Now, the reason why I'm bringing up that particular tier of subscription is because now that they are doing this thing where they are showing their viewing figures twice a year, perfect opportunity to get ad sales, right?
Yes.
Because now they can go to various advertisers and say, right, if you can see that this particularly our lowest rated TV show that has come out is getting 100,000 hours in the space of 2 weeks, in the space of 3 weeks. So if you want to have your ad placed in this particular, and so on and so forth. So remove the altruism from their decision. And it's not that they're now allowing or wanting to generate extra revenue for the people that are buying their products. It's more to get more ad revenue bucks into their pockets. But either way, as they said, rising tide lifts all ships or all boats. Rising tide li lifts all boats. I don't know. It's Christmas. So let me listen. Producer Dave, what are your thoughts on Netflix deciding to now release viewing figures twice a year?
Well, they should have been doing that from time, to be quite honest. A lot of people have always wondered how things are going. And I think, to be quite honest, even though, yes, it's mainly a ploy to get more ad revenue for those people who are going to be paying for the ability to sit there and watch ads, I also think that it's going to help them reduce the amount of bloat that we've got on our system, because they have got a lot of bloat. It is difficult to find something to watch sometimes because there's so much choice.
That's true. That's true. They've got a lot of choices in there, and it is. I mean, hey, but that's why I subscribe to Netflix, because there's quite a lot that's on there. I haven't cut Netflix yet, because every now and again they will pop up with something that's an original, which I watch. They also have a wider range of foreign TV shows and movies. So if
That's
I when
true.
I whenever I feel I need to get into it, especially in the Asian market, especially in the African market as well. So there, I've noticed a lot of African films that are on there, African TV shows, and I'm not talking Nollywood, So it's not Nollywood. So if you're expecting a Nollywood movie, no. This is Netflix production level films from Africa, which is great because a lot of those stories are actually quite good. And the acting, the quality of the films and the TV shows are actually quite good. Vibrant colors, excellent opportunity for people to dive in and see that it's not, you don't just get Nollywood if you watch African cinema. Which is great. So that's what Netflix offers, and that's why I'm pretty much there. And like, hey, they are a big, they're the big bad in the TV studio world. So I'm personally on a whole, on a net loss gain or whatever you want to look at it. I think it's a good idea that they're releasing their viewing figures. It means that the filmmakers can get to see how much or how well their stuff is doing, where before they didn't have that opportunity. Even if Netflix do benefit from it, that's fine. They can benefit from it as much as they want. Either way, anyway, you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And this is Spotlight. So, in Spotlight, since it's Christmas, it's our last show of 2023. We're approaching the Christmas time. Obviously, everyone is diving in to look at Christmas TV shows and Christmas films to get them into the nice, warm spirit of the season. And I figured let's use this opportunity to bring back the old top five favorites that we used to do way back in the day. So for those of you who have been following us, or those of you who haven't been following us as long as I would expect you to, we used to do a segment at the end of the show with our guests where we'd get them to rank their top five favorite comedy movie, top five favorite Eddie Murphy movie, top five favorite movies about action film, top five favorite, whatever, film on a first date, all that kind of stuff. So we figured, since it's Christmas, how about we'll each do top five favorite Christmas movie? I'm sure we've done this. We've been going on for like 5 years now, so I'm pretty sure we've done this at some point. But I'm not gonna go back and look at and listen to any of our episodes. And in fact, it's good to be able to compare and contrast what we had from back then compared to now. So, producer Dave, do you have your top five favorite Christmas movies that you want to talk about today?
I have a top five Christmas movies that I can talk about.
All right, good. Let's see if there's how much crossover there is. Because I put the list together. I put my list together and I was thinking, because I looked at some other top five favorite lists and so on, and I was like, okay, well, is this, what, which, does my list match up with what those ones do, like Time Out and IMDb and so on? And some, there is some crossover, but my number one is not on anyone's number one, but it's my favorite Christmas movie. And so we'll go through it. So let's start with number five. Same as we always do. It's almost, for me anyway, there are going to be a lot of double ups. So let's see how we go. So, pretty, let's start with you. What is your number five favorite Christmas movie?
My number five is a traditional Christmas movie, to be quite honest. It's a Christmas Carol or Scrooge or what have you. It's one of those films.
Sure.
So, it's just one of those films. And I'm not, I could choose one, but I seem to like most of them anyway. So I'm just saying A Christmas Carol.
Okay, that's good. So, and you met, I mean, you talked about Scrooged, which was the Bill Murray one, and there was kind of a new one with Ryan Reynolds and Colin Farrell, with, not Colin Farrell, Will Ferrell. If you were to pick one of those ones as your favorite Christmas Carol movie, which one would you go for?
Oh God, that's really difficult. There's the one that was done in 1999, which starred Patrick Stewart and Grant. I can't remember.
And Richard E. Grant?
Yeah, Richard E. Grant. I think that one.
Okay.
That one's a good one.
Yeah, so not the Muppets one.
No. No. That was good as well,
Fair
but
enough.
no.
Fair enough. Well, my number five is Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. So Kiss Kiss Bang Bang is a oh, what's his name? Shane Black movie. It has Robert Downey Jr., Val Kilmer. Not Ed Harris, but someone, Colin Bernson, that's it, and a number of people. So the story of Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, it's set around Christmas, And it is Robert Downey Jr. is a petty thief. He's running away from a job that he's doing, and from a break-in. The police are chasing him, and he runs into an audition, right? He runs into an audition, and he pretends he's one of the actors who's come in late. And he, with a mixture of emotions of, panicking from having run from the police and having seen his friend shot by the police, he breaks down and he cries and he delivers this piece at the audition. And they're like, "We love you. We're taking you to LA." And so they take him to LA, and he's in there. They want to cast him for this role as a private investigator, and they pair him up with Val Kilmer, who's a private investigator consultant for the studios. And the two of them investigate a murder. Amazing film set at Christmas. It's a noir comedy crime caper set at Christmas. Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Amazing film. My number five. Producer Dave, what's your number four favorite Christmas movie?
For number four, I chose an absolute classic. It's a Wonderful Life.
Okay.
And I'm certain that everyone's heard about it. It's about a man who, just before Christmas, is thinking of committing suicide, and he's shown all the what would have happened to the world if he wasn't in it. So yeah, it's a good spirited Christmas movie. So yes, it's one of those
Jimmy
that's
Stewart, yeah.
it comes out every year. It's there every single year, somewhere.
I love that movie. First time I ever watched it was Christmas Eve, 1999, if I'm not mistaken. That was the first time I ever watched it. Cried my eyes out. Brilliant film. I totally agree. And it is on my, it's my number four as well, but it's sort of a, it again, double header. So I've got two. I've got It's a Wonderful Life and In Bruges. So In Bruges, the Colin Farrell, Brendan Gleeson, Ralph Fiennes movie, where it's about two hitmen who are sent to the city of Bruges to go in and hide out while things die down in London. Amazing film, fantastic. Very sweary film, very, very sweary film. I can't remember the name of the writer director. Martin McDonagh, that's it. Martin McDonagh. His penchant for dialogue is amazing, and that's me, right? That's my thing. Your movie could have no plot. It could have two people just talking to each other, but the dialogue being scintillating, and I'm like, I'm with you all the way. Let's sit in this cafe and chat for hours. I don't care. And that's In Bruges. The characters are brilliant. Colin Farrell is fantastic in it. Brendan Gleeson is even better in it. That's the first film. It's not the first film I saw Brendan Gleeson in, but it's the first film I saw Brendan Gleeson and I remembered his name going forward. He's terrific in it. And Ralph Fiennes is just phenomenal. It's a great film. If you haven't seen it, go check it out. It's I can't. This thing. I can't. I believe it is setting. It's a Christmas. It's in Christmas in Bruges. It's a nice little small town, quaint architectural town, and they're having celebrations of Christmas. It's great. It's my number four, tied with It's a Wonderful Life. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko,
And I'm producer Dave.
and we are doing our top five favorite Christmas movies. As we're running down the year 2023, and we're now on top number three. Producer Dave, what is your number three favorite Christmas movie?
Funny enough, I'm looking at my list again and I'm thinking to myself, oh, maybe this should have been, maybe A Christmas Carol should have been number three and this one should have been number five, Home Alone.
Home Alone, okay.
Yeah, I've put it down as number three, but it maybe should have been number five, and Christmas Carol should have been number three. Just thinking about it, yeah. But Home Alone, everyone knows Home Alone. Little kid gets left behind as his family goes off on a trip, and the house is about to be broken into by some foolish and inept burglars, and the kid outsmarts them in a very, very comedic way at Christmas time, hence the reason why it's classed as a Christmas movie.
What was it? There's going to be another movie that's definitely going to pop up, and I'll talk about that more when we come to it. But yes, the Macaulay Culkin. I kept on trying to think of what his name was. Macaulay Culkin, Joe Pesci, Daniel Stern, if I remember. I think Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern were the two thieves, and Macaulay Culkin was the hero, protagonist, if you look at it from that point of view. I think he's a psychopath, but that's my
A
own.
psychopath in the making, a little brat.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But okay, so see, I did consider putting Home Alone on my list, and I just thought, do I really want to put it on there? I mean, yes, but hey, you've given it recognition, so I'm safe to leave it off my list, because I'm gonna put the Nightmare Before Christmas. That's my number three. Nightmare Before Christmas animation, Tim Burton. The song's fantastic. The animation is, my kids love it. And I think I watched it, I enjoyed it, and I forgot about it. And then my kids wanted to watch it, and they watched it. The second one got bored. The first one was like, yay, he loves it. And so every year we go back in and we watch it again. So A Nightmare Before Christmas is what my number three is. I've landed number three for top favorite Christmas movie. Let's go to number two. Producer Dave, what is your number two favorite Christmas movie?
Actually, my number two is a double header. The double header is A Nightmare Before Christmas and Die Hard.
What? All right. Okay.
Even
That's
though
good.
it's not technically, well, it's technically not a Christmas movie in the sense that it hasn't got all that schmaltzy stuff, but it's set
Oh
around
no.
Christmas.
We're both in agreement that Die Hard is a Christmas movie. So we both agree
Chris,
that. So that's
well,
fine.
Bruce Willis didn't, but but
Didn't he? I thought he
he
did.
didn't think he did. He didn't think it was, but yeah, it's set around Christmas, so yeah.
Okay. Well, funnily enough, you say Die Hard is your number two. Die Hard is my number two as well. I landed it in there. It's number two. Everybody knows Die Hard. The thing is, because I mentioned this when you said Home Alone, I read someone have a quote that said, Home Alone is Die Hard for kids, and Die Hard is Home Alone for adults. And if you think about it, it's perfect, right? It's just because that's what John McClane does. John McClane, Nakatomi Plaza, terrorists come in, try to steal from the Nakatomi Plaza, and he has to defend with whatever he can find. So he sets traps with their stuff, he beats them, he gets the gun, ho, and now I've got a gun, ho, and so on and so forth. And he's making cracking jokes as he's going along. Fantastic. And both films went to spawn off a whole bunch of sequels that went down in quality as they went along. But yes, so Die Hard is my number two favorite Christmas movie. My kid hasn't watched it yet, but he's gearing for it. He wants to watch it this Christmas. So yes, that is lined up for Christmas this year. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And we are now at our top number one favorite Christmas movie of all time. Producer Dave, what is yours?
Unfortunately, it's another double header.
Okay.
Trading Places and Gremlins.
I did not. Okay. I thought we were going to have disparately separate lists, like completely opposite lists. But if I'm not mistaken, apart from number five for me and number three, which you swapped around a little bit with the double header, what 3-2-4-1 or 4-3-2-1 smack bang, almost the same. I didn't put Gremlins on mine because I'll be honest, I think I've seen Gremlins such a long time ago and I can't remember it. I remember bits of it, I remember this whatever, but I don't remember having seen it from beginning to end. So Gremlins is not on my
Oh,
list.
you need to watch it from the beginning. It's hilarious. It was brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
I've seen so many clips of it, but I've never really seen it. Yeah, I can't remember having
Now
seen
you
it
need
from
to sit and watch it. It is just from even your kids will love it. It's
Will do.
yeah,
Will do.
just great
But
stuff.
Trading Places, number one. Absolutely. Trading Places is my number one favorite Christmas movie, same as yourself. Eddie Murphy, Dan Aykroyd. It's Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yep.
What you have is two bankers or two stock exchange billionaires have this thing where they like to make a bet with each other. They're brothers. They like to make bets with each other that ruins people's lives, essentially. And their bet this year, this Christmas, is a nature nurture debate where they say, if they take what happens if they swap their number one, the number one, stock trader, number one protege, played by Dan Aykroyd, if they swap his conditions with a bum that they find on the street, played by Eddie Murphy, if they swap them, will they be able to maintain, or will they carry on in their own path as they are? So Dan Aykroyd's character, will he, the fact that he's had everything given to him, he's born in a rich family, he's gone to Harvard, and he's now being, everything is, the world is his oyster. Whereas Eddie Murphy's character, he's a crook, he's on the street, you see him actually swindling because he's pretending to be a cripple and whatnot, and they say, okay, if we swap them, will they still carry on, or will Eddie Murphy carry on being a criminal, and will Dan Aykroyd whatever, would he succeed, would he pull himself by the bootstraps and become successful? That's the premise of Trading Places. Fantastic movie. And it, for me, it there, this is how great the movie is for me. Whenever I wish people, greetings, season's greetings, essentially, I use the season's greetings of Happy Christmas and a Merry New Year as all, what I always done because of Trading Places. If you know, if you've seen the movie, you know exactly what I'm talking about. That is a great movie and one of Eddie Murphy's finest. Go check it out if you haven't seen it. Producer Dave, what sticks out to you in Trading Places? What makes it your favorite?
Well, apart from that scene, the way in which Dan Aykroyd actually turns into a bum. There's a scene where he's wandering down the street dressed in as Santa Claus, and he is. I think that's the forerunner of Bad Santa, to be quite honest, because he's just like staggering down the street, Santa Claus outfit on, and he stops and he's drinking all the, he drinks all the hooch all the way down. Chucks the bottle away and goes, it was just hilarious.
And he's stealing, he steals a whole salmon, massive salmon, and he shoves it down his down his throat. Yeah, absolutely. You know what? Lining that up as well. Those are my top five. I'm gonna line them up for Christmas. Okay, so we've now come to the end of our show, which has been, it's been a long 2023. I want to, if you're listening to this, I want to thank you very much, because you didn't have to download Shoot the Breeze, didn't have to listen to us rant for an hour to get to this point. But hey, you know what? There were so many other podcasts or episodes that you're, on Resonance FM that you could have listened to, and Resonance FM have great shows. You should definitely listen to it. And you chose to listen to us, and I thank you very much for that. I also thank Resonance for not listening to us at all, because oof, if they had any sense, they would have cancelled us long time ago. But they didn't, and so they left us to carry on. And we're going to be going into 2024, I believe, unless I get an email before Christmas, and we'll see what happens. And one person I definitely want to thank very much for sticking with me, Producer Dave. You've stuck with me for close to 5 years. You've listened to me rant, and I've been throwing you under the bus numerous times.
Sorry
I'm
about
sure I've done it at least 3 times in this episode alone.
it.
I want to thank you very much for sticking by me and allowing me to rant at someone. Because if it wasn't you, I would be ranting at myself, and in a few days I would get committed for that. So thank you very much for saving me from being committed to an asylum for just talking nonstop of my own theories. So I want to thank you very much, and I want to wish you a happy Christmas. I want to wish all of you, all that have listened to the show, and all of you who are listening to Resonance FM, I want to wish you all a Merry Christmas. You have been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I have been Marcus E. Acko.
And you're listening to a very grateful producer, Dave.
Then thank you very much for listening.
And speak to you all next time. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year! Merry New
Merry New
Year!
Year. Bye.